Welcome to MCLA's College Roundtable. I'm your host, Caitlin Wright. Today, I have the distinct honor of interviewing Governor Jane Swift. Swift is a native of Berkshire County. In fact, she was born right here in North Adams. Swift left the Berkshires during her college days to attend Trinity in neighboring Connecticut, where she received a degree in American Studies. However, it was not long before she returned to the area, becoming heavily involved in the Berkshire County Republican Party and making a successful bid for her state Senate district at the young age of 25. Swift has an extensive career in public service, serving on the Massachusetts State Senate, as Secretary of Consumer Affairs under Governor Bill Weld, as Lieutenant Governor under Governor Paul Cellucci, and finally as Acting Governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts from 2001 to 2003. Following her tenure in Massachusetts politics, Swift spent some time as a lecturer at Williams College. Most recently, she has taken up a career as the CEO of Middlebury Interactive Languages, which is a world leader in language instruction for kindergartners to 12th graders. I know I speak not only for myself, but the entire MCLA community when I say that we are happy to have you join us today, and thank you for coming to speak to our campus and the North Adams community as well.
And I'm so excited to be here for your television debut.
Yeah, this is very exciting. First time on TV for me. So I guess my first question for you, and to kind of tie it into MCLA being a liberal arts school, Trinity is also a liberal arts college as well. Mm-hmm. So how do you feel that your liberal arts education has helped shape your career path as well as your life path as well?
So that's a great question, and I can actually work in an MCLA experience. So I was an American Studies major with a political science concentration at Trinity, and one of the hardest classes I ever took was my junior seminar, and we would read these really long books every week, and we would have to distill it into a short paper. And it's when I discovered that taking really complex thoughts and synthesizing them into short papers was actually harder than just writing and writing and writing. And by the time I became governor, but even as an aide and then a state senator, I would have just reams of information that I would have to absorb, think about how it impacted the people that I represented, how it impacted the positions that I wanted to take, and really just like lots and lots and lots of pages of information, which is probably not too different from what you do in your classes. But this is where the MCLA, which was then North Adams State College, it was the worst course of my entire academic life. I got a C. I have never gotten a C. It's the only C I ever got, and it really shook my confidence because I had been a great writer when I attended Drury High School. I actually went to college thinking I was going to be an English major, and I came back that summer to North Adams after going abroad for a semester, and I really was a little bit lost. And I actually enrolled in a summer course here on campus and took a writing course. And the professor, and I'm going to forget his name, but it was a creative writing course. And about halfway through the course, we were supposed to be writing just stories. And he called me into his office. I thought I was in trouble again. And he said, "You're a great writer. Why are you here?" And I like broke down and told him the whole story about how I had gotten a C+, actually, and that I had written all these papers. And he said, "So you don't need to do creative writing this summer. Why don't you bring me in the papers that you wrote for that class, and let's go over them, and I'll tell you what I think you did wrong, what I think you could do better." And he basically tutored me for the rest of the summer. I didn't transfer those credits for graduation, even though that was my initial plan to try to give myself a little more room for graduation. I was so nerve-wracked that I wasn't going to graduate on time or something, but it actually restored my confidence, and he showed me just some basic things that I was, I wasn't having confidence in my own thoughts, and it just was a great lesson that failure sometimes can teach you more about yourself, and working to overcome failure can be some of the most important important lessons that you learn. So a liberal arts education can teach you the specific skills, but also college in general and some of the failures you have in academics can also be really important as you grow into a professional.
That's awesome to hear, and it's great to hear that professors at MCLA back then were just as accommodating and really there for students as they are today. So I guess continuing on with the MCLA campus and community thing, following the election, and I know you kind of didn't want to talk about that too much, but on our campus, and I'm sure on campuses across the country, there was a great deal of tension. So what do you think that we can do as students to bridge our ideological differences to unite under a common goal?
So first of all, I don't think people should be afraid of voicing different ideas. About 15 or 20 years ago, former President Bill Clinton wrote about this growing phenomenon in the United States where increasingly people were living in communities and attending churches where people thought more similarly about politics. With the proliferation of cable channels, people tend to watch the news channel that shares their perspective, and I think that's really dangerous. I actually just went back to Trinity on Monday night and spoke about intellectual diversity. It's important to know that you can like people who have a different opinion than you have, and frankly, we have really tough issues that we need to solve as Americans, and I think the best ideas come from people with different opinions, debating, discussing, thinking about the other person's position. When I was in the state Senate, I was 25 years old. Like most 25-year-olds, I thought I knew everything, but it turns out there were a lot of life experiences I hadn't had yet. And listening to some of my colleagues and hearing their perspectives, actually, sometimes it strengthened my arguments because it made me think more deeply about my position, but sometimes I changed some aspects of the legislation that I was sponsoring. So I think the only way we are going to solve the toughest issues that we face as a country is by listening to lots of points of view. And I think we've lost that in a way because we tend to surround ourselves both in the media, but really even in person with people who share our viewpoint. And until we learn that you can like people who think differently and vote differently than you do, that there's actually a value in thinking about whether or not your position on something is the right position, and there's no shame in you know, maybe amending some aspect of how you think about something, I don't think we're going to be able to tackle some of the biggest public policy challenges that we face. And frankly, in addition to politics, when you go into the work world, flexibility and creativity are all about thinking about lots of different problems and ideas in different ways. And those skills of thinking about different viewpoints are going to be really valuable in the private sector, too.
So in terms of different viewpoints, so you ran as a Republican in a very liberal area. How did you, you know, how did you manage to win that campaign in a way? Or really what brought about your views, I suppose, because I mean, I know I speak for myself and the rest of the college Republicans on campus, like we're a very, you know, small group and we're kind of the minority. So how did you go about doing it?
Okay, so a couple of things. First of all, it was 30 years ago almost, 27 to be exact. The Berkshires have changed. It wasn't as liberal as it is today, and so that's the first thing you need to understand is the political climate, and even the Berkshires have become more liberal than they were. But also, I didn't feel constrained by party labels. I went out and talked to people about the things I thought were important. I thought that public education being excellent for every person and every kid who grew up in North Adams or Great Barrington or Pittsfield was really critical, and I had very specific ideas about how I thought that could happen, and I had credibility. I went, you know, to Drury High School right up the road. My mom had taught in the public schools here, and I think at the local level in particular, being really specific about the things you believe. I also was a Republican who believed that environmental protection was really critical, and that was a position that was pretty well accepted back in the day. The Republican senators who had come before me, Peter Weber and Jack Fitzpatrick, also had very strong credentials in, you know, protecting agriculture and seeing that as consistent with environmental protection. Hunters' rights were actually pretty consistent as well with environmental protection. But I also grew up in a small business family. We ran a local plumbing company, and I understood that the expense of regulation and high taxes was jobs and job loss for neighbors and families. And so I was able to articulate it in a personal way that I think resonated.
So during your tenure as state senator, you really advocated for a lot of education policies, in particular the Education Reform Act of 1993, which implemented the MCAS system. So what are your thoughts on the progress of MCAS today?
Well, I don't think you can argue with the success. So it was so controversial when we passed it in 1993, and I was lucky to both be in the Senate and one of the six members of the legislature who helped to write the final bill. I then was in the governor's office and lieutenant governor's office when we implemented it. Massachusetts today has, it's not even argued anymore, the best public education system in the country, and in many cases, we're competitive internationally with math and science. Students who go to our public schools here can compete with kids who go to private schools almost anywhere else in the country, and that is a phenomenal advantage that I am so proud that we achieved. But there's been a lot of controversy about testing, and I do think in some cases there are some states who focused more on the test than on the curriculum. And one of the things that we did in Massachusetts is we made sure that what the test measured was the knowledge that students needed to be successful. And I think that's why we didn't narrow the curriculum here. You could have a robust arts curriculum and still do well. In fact, you might do better on the MCAS exams. We made sure we were measuring the right skills in our science curriculum. And so I think it's been very successful, and I regret that when folks tried to model that with the National Common Core standards. They thought they were modeling what we did well in Massachusetts, but I think they missed some of the key learnings.
Yeah, that's certainly disappointing, and I know Common Core has, I'm not maybe not so more recently, but in the last couple of years, faced a lot of heat. So I guess, sorry, where do you see education policy going in the future, or where would you like to see it at least under this administration?
So I think Common Core is going to be rolled back. I think states are going to be given a lot more power. I think for folks in Massachusetts, it's no time to rest on our laurels. And Jim Pizer, who is Governor Baker's advisor on education, is somebody I worked with. He's phenomenal. Chris Gabrielli, who's someone I also worked with, who is doing higher education policy, is also a terrific public servant. We are so lucky in Massachusetts to have really bright, very committed education policy leaders. And so I think we'll keep pressing forward. There's still a need to do more in STEM, particularly to encourage girls to be more ambitious about technology and engineering and math. And so I hope we'll push forward on that. But I also think this whole issue of making higher education more affordable for more people is important. And then the area I've really focused on lately, I just read something in a report recently that really disturbed me, which is around the long waiting lists for vocational and technical education programs in Massachusetts. There are a lot of individuals who are getting a great high school education who, for a variety of reasons, choose to pursue certificate programs and technical training and not a bachelor's degree, and we just aren't doing a good enough job for those students in getting them affordable options that prepare them for the openings that exist in our economy. So those middle skills jobs that are out there and that can provide a pathway to a great life and support of their family. And so I think more intermediary training opportunities at an affordable price is where we should be focusing next.
I'm actually a product of a technical school. I went to Whittier Tech in Haverhill.
Oh, good.
And I know Governor Baker recently has been granting money for grants to technical schools, specifically my own department that I was in. And so I'm really glad to hear that you're a proponent of them as well, because, I mean, granted, I didn't continue into the field that I did in high school, but, you know, I have that background, and I know a lot of friends that were able to get jobs right out of high school, and they've done really well so far. And if more people would advocate for it or consider it as an option, because I feel like students are, they don't want to go into a technical school because they feel like it limits their academic ability. But I mean, I speak for myself and everybody that I went to high school with that it certainly didn't.
Well, one of the key things we did when we did the education reform bill is that we insisted that there were still strong academic standards for students in vocational and technical schools in Massachusetts. And that was really controversial at the time. But in fact, it made it possible that students who chose that path could still go on to a four-year college education if they wanted to. But what you're seeing around the country is that a lot of students who might have the technical skills don't have the soft skills in math and science that those jobs require. That's not the case in Massachusetts. And in fact, there are now long wait lists for those programs. So we did something right. Now we just have to make sure that we expand the number of openings in those programs so more students can benefit from it. So I'm so happy to hear that you took that path and it worked well for you.
Yes, I really loved that opportunity. So again, tying it back to your state senate days, did you find it ever challenging to, you know, bridge Eastern and Western Mass together? I know it was kind of brought up a little bit in your Q&A earlier.
I think I just rolled my eyes and it probably got caught on the camera. Yes.
Okay, short answer. Fair enough. Well, I guess, do you see this as a continuing problem? And really, what is the best way to address it?
So Massachusetts is a unique state. So we're a big state in a lot of ways, right? We have a pretty significant economy. We're well known. We have great sports teams. But geographically, we're pretty compact. We're one of the few states where our geographic capital and our business center and our political capital are all like right together in the same place. And so that concentrates a lot of power really close to Boston. There are very few places in Massachusetts that are more than an hour and a half away without traffic from that center point. Cape Cod, some parts of the North Shore, certainly the islands, and then Western Massachusetts. And so the issues that impact those areas are very different, but they also have much less economic and population power. And so we really rely on our elected officials, both at the federal and the state level, to work collaboratively with other regions, and frankly, to ensure that their voice is heard, not through numbers, but through being really well-versed and working in a bipartisan way, which we've seen pretty successfully in this region, to make sure our needs, because our needs are different, and our education needs, our economic needs will be met in a different way, and policies will need to be amended to meet our needs in the state capital.
So I know recently there's been some talk on Beacon Hill about the possibility of a rail link between Springfield and Boston. What are your thoughts on that? Do you think that's something that is there's a need for it out in Western Mass, or?
So I think in general, enhanced transportation is fantastic. It's something I supported when I was in a public policy position. I would argue, or at least warn against it being seen as a panacea. Just getting more quickly from Boston to Springfield isn't going to change the fact that you know, you will still have a lot of capital, a lot of world-class colleges and universities, alongside a lot of world-class hospitals and teaching hospitals all close together in Boston that create a dynamic economic vibrancy in Boston that really defines that region that you're just not going to have in Western Massachusetts with or without a rail link. And that is just the reality that we have to accept and be glad we're part of this wonderful state with all of those opportunities.
Absolutely. So after you were the state senator, you went on and you were the Secretary of Consumer Affairs, but following that, you were elected as lieutenant governor and then as acting governor. So what was the most challenging part about being governor? I know that's a very broad question, but...
So first of all, it was a fantastic job, and one of the other things I'm going to talk about tonight is I hope more young women will take the opportunity to run for office. We do face lots of challenges as a country and as a state and as a community, and I think young women have a lot of the answers, so I hope you'll run. Research tells us women don't run enough, and they don't get asked to run often enough, so I make it my personal mission whenever I find young women who are interested in public policy to invite them to run. So there you go. Run for something. We need you. And I'm going to do that more broadly to the young women tonight. When I was elected, I was the first woman to serve as governor of Massachusetts, but I was also the first governor in the country to give birth to my children. And so there was a lot of focus, and this has been proven out through research for women in executive positions, a lot of focus on my family. And that really distracted from my ability to be known for some of the issues that I was passionate about around education, around improving the business climate for small businesses. And so that was a real frustration for me. And it was a personal frustration because I didn't want to diminish how important it was to become a mother. It was and continues to be the most important thing that's ever happened in my life. My kids are the center of my world. And so that was a really hard personal challenge to have the thing that was so important to me personally be such a distraction politically and professionally. But it gave me great perspective. And I think it made me, in some ways, a better leader because I had that perspective. And then, of course, I had the responsibility of being governor on 9/11. Yeah. And I had the challenge of having the single biggest policy issue that faced me when I was governor be around a policy area that I really had never chosen to focus on, that I had very little personal experience with, terrorism, public safety, really had never been a focus of my sort of public policy platform. And so that taught me things as well. I had to figure out how to lead on an issue and make decisions on an issue and form consensus on an issue, relying on a lot of folks who knew a heck of a lot more about something than I did. That was a great leadership lesson, but that changed me as well and has given me a broader focus on issues around girls' education internationally. So I continue to serve on an advisory board for a school of leadership for girls in Afghanistan. I don't have nearly any of the solutions to the issues that are challenging us in the Middle East, but I'm pretty sure that just like domestically electing more women to office, educating more girls in the Middle East and in some Muslim countries is a big part of the solution.
Awesome. I'm actually taking a woman in politics class this semester, so pretty much everything you just said in that answer is a synopsis of the class. So I'm glad to know that everything that you said is, you know, something that happens in the real world as well, too. So I guess my final question for you would be, what would be your advice to any woman, young or old, who wants to get involved in politics?
So whether it's politics or banking or teaching, whatever you want to do, follow your passion. Don't be afraid to fail. You you learn from your failures almost as much as you learn from your successes. And frankly, you're only successful if you're not afraid to fail. And you can't, every political campaign, one person loses. But don't ever run for an office without 100% intention of winning. And run for the right reasons. Run because you want to change something, because there is an issue. You saw me speaking upstairs earlier, and I sort of got all worked up, and I'm not running for anything anymore.
I love to see the passion.
But, you know, I care so deeply about policy and the direction that our community and our states and our country is taking. And I'm a policy wonk, and I, you know, dig down beyond the headlines. I think a lot of times women do know their stuff, but don't be afraid. You don't have to know everything. You don't have to be, you know, an expert in every single issue. You just have to feel really strongly about a couple of issues, and then have confidence in the people you surround yourself with, and you'll do great. And don't be afraid to run.
No, definitely. It is my plan. 2032 is the year I can run for president.
You know what?
Not that I'm planning it or anything just yet. But hopefully, someday. So if you could go back, would you do it all again?
I would. Don't tell my husband. I had so many great experiences. Some of them were just downright fun, but others were so meaningful. You know, I got to reform our child welfare system. I got to do a lot of really critical improvements to our public education system. Just so many big and little things. And I know the state from one end to the other. And at the end of the day, I have met so many people. I think the thing I bugs me the most, the smartest, most talented people I have met and worked with were in government. They cared passionately. Even the ones I disagreed with were good people who cared a lot about the future of their community, their state, their country, and that's important for everybody to know.
All right, well, this has been such an honor and a pleasure to be able to speak to you and ask you these questions. So I really do appreciate you coming here and, you know, speaking with us and speaking to the MCLA community and North Adams community as well later on this evening.
It's my hometown. I'm thrilled to do it.
Thank you.